have been running for 20 years, and although there hasn't been a podcast at all that time, there are still a lot of podcasts there, so you can be entertained that way too. And a lot of writing as well from philosophy and such investigations. Just a couple of housekeeping issues, if you wouldn't mind putting on the volume on your phone, that would be much appreciated. Feel free to leave your phone on and speak along with the event. I think we have our own FEP, RFP, John Conversation on this has been recorded as a podcast, and something is also being filmed. So if you ask a question, just bear in mind that it will be recorded. And do wait for the roaming mic to come to you, just because other people in the room want to hear the question, and if you can find the podcast as well. That's more than enough for me. Thank you again for coming.
Thank you, Beth. My name is Danielle Sands. I'm a fellow at the Forum, and I'm going to be chairing this evening's event. Just a quick note about the strikes before we begin. The Forum is an independent charity. It's not an academic institution. And our events are aimed at a public rather than an academic audience. Those of us on the panel who are UK-based are striking at our academic institutions, and that's the reason why you don't see any of our academic affiliations on the slide, and I'm not going to mention them either. One last note, and I hope this goes without saying, that the Forum offers its full support to all striking academics, professional staff, and support staff involved in the current dispute. So I'd like to welcome our speakers this evening, Priya Gopal, Nasser Mir, and Kwame Anthony Appiah. The discussion will be very informal. There'll be lots of points where you can jump in with questions, and then we'll have some more time for questions. So the topic we are discussing this evening is the philosophy of race. Perhaps, Anthony, we can start with you. Perhaps you might tell us a little bit about what we're talking about when we talk about race.
Well, we're talking about something that we made up. When I say we, it was made up in different ways in different places, different times. The sort of strong form of racial thinking that is present in the United Kingdom today has its own specific history. My own view is that it's very much connected with two things. First of all, the slave trade and the need to find rationalizations for the treatment of black people in the slave trade. And second, something completely different, which is the rise of a certain kind of biological thinking in the 19th century, which turned a category that was social and imaginatively perhaps natural into a supposedly scientific category in the 19th century. So what was the idea? Well, the idea was that you could divide the world into a small number of groups, and each group had some hereditary things about it that were handed on from parental members of the group to the descendant members of the group. And that those things, and I think this is a key part of what developed in the late 19th century in Britain and in the North Atlantic world more generally, that didn't just affect your skin and your hair and the shape of your nose and how big your lips were and whether your teeth were sharp or not, but it affected poetry and culture and philosophy and religion. This was a deep thing. W.B. Du Bois said that it was physical for sure, but more deeply it was psychical and spiritual. And this is an African American speaking in the late 19th century. So I think that's sort of now we've inherited something slightly different from that. The biologists aren't on the side of this anymore, for one thing, but we still have, I think, we live with the legacy of that kind of thinking. And just to make one final point, things like this, descent-based characterizing people, are not the unique prerogative of the North Atlantic. People do this all over the world, and so there's a family resemblance between the ways in which we think about race, what we call race now, in lots of places.
So how do we move from thinking, if you say that the history of this category is something we think about biologically, but that does no longer hold. Is the category of race useful in other senses? Is it something that we've repurposed in fruitful ways?
I don't think I should be the only person, because that seems to be a question that we all don't have views about.
Well, I mean, as Anthony suggests, it's was seen as a biological category, but it's actually in most ways historical. And the fact that something is historical and not biological doesn't mean it's not real. It doesn't mean it doesn't have an operative force, you know, whether we like it or not. And although a lot of people talk about being colorblind or not seeing race, the fact is that we all have some kind of racial identity within which we are seen and within which we work. So in a sense, it's not up to us, you know, whether we accept race or not. Race takes us. So yes, I mean, repurposing is one way to look at it. Another way to look at it is that thinking about race, about our own racializing and the way in which we racialize other people is very important to self-understanding, to thinking about how we became who we are and how we think about ourselves in relation to other people. That doesn't mean race is an essence. It doesn't mean it's an absolute unmoving truth. But it does have a very important operative force in society, and we have to understand the ways in which it works before we can get to a point that some people like to call post-racial. Or even to get to a point of equality, you actually have to think about what race is and how it operates in your life and in everyday life.
So we should think of it as a kind of imposed identity?
I mean, we can think of it in terms of external attribution, but I think that would undermine how people have responded to it and create a form of agency in terms of rejecting certain attributions of race. I mean, the category of black was a pejorative term until it was retaken by African-Americans and turned from a negative to a positive. Yeah, you know, black man proud. I mean, the prevailing term, I think, was colour. But I mean,
there's a great history.
There is, of course.
Yeah. My favourite term in the 19th century was Afro-Saxon.
I've heard them play. So I suppose there's something about the agency and the ways in which race as a means of resisting forms of attribution can be a vehicle for self-empowerment, and I certainly wouldn't want to overlook that. And I think that's sometimes one thing that anti-racists don't properly understand. You know, they fall around this semantic idea of race and think, well, if we do away with a term, sure, we'll do away with a problem. I suppose I share with you what you said so far. One issue which always strikes me is in the shift from race as lineage, which may or may not be relatively banal, to a much more organised, concrete taxonomy with scientific, what we call scientific racism. I'm always struck by the fact that in the contemporary racialisation of some groups, there's a certain repository which is drawn upon, and I work a lot on Muslims and Islamophobia, and I often find that in the rhetoric on Muslims, there's a continuity with things that have been said before, which is prior to the scientific racism changing of race. Now, I'm not suggesting there's direct linear one-to-one continuity, but there are interesting antecedents, which then suggest that, well, you know, race has this historically powerful, recurring salience in purchase, and if we want to understand some of the bigger things around who we are, whether a nation or something else, then, you know, we need to dip into a prior history of race, perhaps, too.
Yeah, well, I do think that it is important. I mean, when you say, so I think the particular way of thinking about race that sort of crystallized in the mid-18th century is just one way. But as you say, ideas of peoplehood are antique, are the earliest texts we have, talk about kinds of people. And we know that they imagined them as were inheriting their membership from their parents, so they thought of it as sort of lineage-based, as descent-based. And also, as I would say, in some sense, is essentialist. What changes in the early 19th century is that the essence comes to be biological, but if you think about the ways in which Jews were talked about in the 14th, 15th, 16th centuries in Spain, say, there, it's not biology, the word biology was invented in 1800, but it's nevertheless the idea that, this person who is Jewish can convert, can become one of the conversos, but there's still really something in there, some essence,
intrinsic.
Some intrinsic they used the language of blood, actually. So that there's some blood, some Jewish blood. And that means that if your deal with your Jewish, and in that case Muslim populations, is, well, you can stick around as long as you become Christian. If you then have a story according to which you can't become Christian, then there's no place for you. And as you know, 1492, Jews were expelled from Spain. So I think that's another place where the story that develops in the 18th century has sort of looks back to. But it looks back to, you know, ideas about Philistines and Assyrians and Achaeans and all that other stuff. But the key thing is that human beings. So there's a sort of psychological part of the story, I think, which is that we are very prone to essentialize groups. We're very prone to think that, well, we can distinguish these people from these people, so there must be some deep thing inside these people that's different from some deep thing inside these people that explains why we can tell them apart. And that deep thing is then going to lead us to feel that we should treat these people differently from these people, especially if one of these people is us. So the idea that we are held together by some essence of usness, and they are held together by some essence of themness, I think that's a very widespread pattern, and it's to do with the deep feature of our psychology, then.
I'm interested in the way in which race becomes used to serve as a kind of political economy, and 1492 is really quite important then, not only because of what happens in Europe and the Reconquista, but also, of course, then the Christian colonization or Catholic colonization of North America and the native peoples there. There is a continuing question over the extent which race serves that function, I think.
You mean then or now?
Now.
Oh, I see.
I think that one of the ways in which we can understand contemporary forms of racialization is very much driven by questions of political economy, not solely on economy. I don't think that helps us to understand or explain Islamophobia, but I think it helps to understand and explain forms of racialization of, say, white folks.
Well, you know, actually, political economy was never not there. And if you think about the ways in which you talk about historical categorizations emerging from slavery and then continuing into the empire, labor was a very big part of that. I mean, I think you touched on that, the idea that, so for instance, Thomas Carlyle writes a famous attack on black people, quashy, as lazy, as sitting outside their huts, grinning and eating pumpkins with the juice running down their face. Why are black people in the mid to late 19th century seen as lazy? In part because they're resisting. And they're resisting political economy. They are resisting being transformed from slaves into so-called free wage laborers. They don't want to become laborers for hire on farms in Jamaica or in Trinidad. They want to look after their own piece of land and be self-sustaining. So what you get in the 19th century are these really angry tirades in the Times of London and similar, you know, British newspapers about how lazy blacks are and how, in fact, they need to be put to work, because if you don't put them to work, all they're going to do is sit outside their hut and eat pumpkins because they have no need to work. And so here you see the refusal to be wage laborers, and many black freed blacks and their descendants absolutely refuse to work for their former masters in their plantations. And here you can see how blackness becomes connected to laziness, because you have a form of resistance that says, no, we're not going to become part of the wage economy of plantation labor, because we know what it's like to work on a plantation, and it wasn't fun, and the pitiful wages you're offering are not worth the economic slavery that will entail.
The question of stereotypes is coming up here, and the way that stereotypical characterizations have originated. I wondered if you could talk a bit about that, the relationship between our understanding of race and the way that leads into kind of racist stereotypes.
Well, I just touched on it, so maybe.
I mean, clearly it's an important part of the story, and it's one of the ways in which, as a result of that, pictures develop. Kinds of people, and they may have their origins in specific moments in the political economy, but they kind of live on after the political economy has changed. So blacks get identified as lazy because they won't work in the system that's trying to be imposed on them after emancipation. Blacks to slavery, blacks are lazy, goes into colonial discourse where it's serving a different function and where what's being resisted is not just a labor regime, but about total imposition of the colonial system and the system of command and so on. So, these stereotypes are very powerful, I think. And again, there are certainly all forms of identity have stereotypes associated with them. And the key thing, I think, to see is that what's striking about them is that even if there's some truth in them, they're almost always way less true than would be necessary to justify continuing using them. And often they're just totally bogus. I mean, so if one tries to think about, Jews are stereotyped as dishonest, but if you're involved as Jews were before, because they weren't allowed to own land in banking and finance, on a small scale as well as a large scale, you can't be dishonest. Right? It's the only asset you've got. So actually, that's not just, as a little bit misleading. It's about as misleading as you could possibly be in that particular case because the association. So there are just lots of examples like that, I think, where you're saying that blacks are lazy when you've just ended a labor system in which blacks were working day and night and producing the material
And they were saying that. I mean, if you look at testimony from former slaves, they're saying we work like mad, and yet we get neither money nor appreciation, despite the fact that our labor is being extracted. And there are some really eloquent, speeches and testimonies and legal documents which speak of this awareness of being racialized because of the way in which your labor is extracted.
I mean, as a social scientist, my students don't get much exposure to literature, but the literature that I do share with them on this topic comes from Elizabethan England. It's the work of Shakespeare. And students get to learn about the portrayal of Othello and Shylock, who, by contemporary standards, are replete with redeeming qualities. They're very polysemic. Nonetheless, they are a certain kind of racialized affectation of characters of their time. Jews hadn't been readmitted to Britain by the time. Shakespeare was writing The Merchant of Venice. Yet he had this prior notion of Jewry in his head, which informs the kind of tragic figure of Shylock. And of course, there was a moral panic during the time that Shakespeare was writing Othello in London about the place of Ottomans. And indeed, Queen Quinlan was the first to even had an edict suggesting they should be all expelled. So these stereotypes are ingrained in our stories that we define as telling something meaningful about who we are, as British, for example. Shakespeare always pops up in top ten surveys of things that make you proud about it, throw something like that. And then, of course, it's one of those narratives about who we are that is deeply racialized in ways that perhaps we don't all appreciate.
Yeah, I think one of the odd things about Merchant of Venice is that the only racialized kind of money lending in London in Elizabethan times, paradoxically, was by Italian Catholics, the bankers from Lombardy, so that Shakespeare's audience knew that the group from which Antonio comes was actually engaging in money lending down the street, while in the play, as a good Christian, he presents himself as someone who will lend money, but only without without interest. So there's lots of paradoxes, I think, about as always with Shakespeare.
Yeah.
What's really going on is I think quite
complicated. But the fact that he could draw on stereotypes of Jews in a country without Jews is the point. So these stereotypes, and there aren't many. Most Elizabethan English people haven't seen a Moorish general like Othello. So ideas about who he is are nevertheless deeply available in the culture, and ideas, stereotypes about. Already we have, in the case of Othello, the association of black people with sexual appetite, the lascivious. Othello has lascivious lips, thick lips, which are associated with lasciviousness and so on. And again, this is in a country where there's no representation. This isn't a stereotype of an actually existing significant population of people. I don't mean there were no black people in England. But so the stereotypes are very, very powerful, and they do their work, even if there's hardly anybody empirically to represent the category of this.
I want to muddy that terrain just a little bit, though, because Elizabeth I expels blackamoors from the kingdom. So there are blackamoors in Elizabethan England. They are not racialized and then re-racialized as she expels them as foreigners. I think, and you touched on this, and it's very important, Shakespeare on the one hand is drawing on stereotypes and playing with them, but no society has a very static view of everything. People in any society disagree with each other, they also challenge stereotypes. So in Othello, in The Merchant of Venice, in The Tempest, we also get a challenging of racial discourse. We also get stereotypes. I mean, famously and very obviously, hath not a Jew eyes too, right? I mean, the idea, you also get speaking, self-representing characters who challenge dominant stereotypes. Now, Caliban in The Tempest is a monster, but he's also someone who remains an icon as a person who resisted colonialism, who said, "You have taught me your language so that I might curse with it," right? So he represents those people who took ideas from Britain or from Europe and turns them against Britain and Europe and colonialism. So I think it's important to think about paradoxes and ambiguities and the fact that with every stereotype there is also a pointing towards a counter stereotype and a complication of the picture.
It's really important what you say, it's really important, and I think it's important also because it suggests a way we can draw on history, which is not just to focus on, as it were, the racist stereotypes and the bad moments, but to notice that we have traditions to draw on that are ways of fighting back against those stereotypes, so that we want both to acknowledge that our intellectual ancestors had failings, but also to notice that they made arguments, they made good arguments about these things. In the Jewish Altar, Marlowe's character has the Barabbas, the Jew, say, he makes the best argument against holding people responsible for their group that you could make. He says, "But say the tribe that I descended of were all in general cast away for sin. Shall I be tried by their transgression?" He's saying, "You're using your stereotype, you're treating me as the Jew. But shouldn't you look at me? Shouldn't you decide whether I did any of those things? Should I be held responsible for what they've done?" And so that argument is in play, even in a play that's, Barabbas is not the most super attractive character in this drama. So I think it's important because it means that we have within our traditions resources to draw on. We don't have to reinvent all the arguments. Many of the arguments are made all along. I like to remind people that it's true that Aristotle endorsed slavery for people which he thought were natural slaves. But arguments against slavery were already in play in his culture. It wasn't as if a monologue, a polylogue about these things. So I think we can draw on different pictures from the bad ones, even if they're the dominant ones at some point. I think another thing you said is really important is that this is a shifting thing, so that the dominant stereotypes shift very much. I mean, we were talking earlier about this, but that's very strikingly true of the Irish, right, who are essentially racialized as un-English,
barely European, as it were.
Savages.
Savages. Yeah. Well, in North America, well into the 19th century, into the early 20th century. Now that's not part of the dominant picture of the Irish in North America.
And I think that's illustrated by a whole series of particularly white Catholics. I mean, Trump's phrase about shithole country reminded me of the phrase of the US state when migration from Europe changed from north to south, and in the early 20th century people were coming from Sicily and from Italy. What was the phrase? Europe vomiting.
Yeah.
So white categories, interestingly, have been subjectively formed of racialization in the past, but in ways in which they have overcome, to some extent. The Irish case is fascinating. There was an almost dialectical relationship between them and blackness and Irish for a moment, reference to Irish smoked N-words and so on. But there's a certain currency in whiteness, isn't there? That people of colour don't have. You can pass someone of the names. You're surveyed in a different way, even though you may take pride in your Italian history or your Irish history or your kind of non-European history. As an American, you are in. They have to fight to be part of an American story in a way in which I don't see why children have anything to fight.
Right, and I still think that we see this in some of the support for the current president of the United States. Whom I will not name. There is a kind of sense that, in fact, there's a straightforward rhetoric of a white nation and a white Christian nation and so on, which is not endorsed in the mainstream, but very much present, nevertheless, in the background, that has been there to some extent in waves up and down all along. And I think, the dominant, I think it's true that the dominant, the Immigration and Naturalization Service of the United States has just taken out of its webpage its description of the United States as a nation of immigrants.
Yeah.
Presumably under direction from somebody appointed by the current president. But that's not going to work because, at least not in the short run, because most Americans continue to think of the United States as a nation of immigrants, including in that understanding non-white immigrants, understanding that immigration brings people from everywhere, as where the world has come. That's different, I think, from a difficulty that you have in Europe, which is that Europe continues to be imagined as white, so that there are lots of anti-racist, non-racist, decent Europeans who are perfectly happy to have non-white people around, but they think of them as kind of guests or people that they're being nice to, or that they're not really, as it were, automatically entitled to be here. And that's even true when they have ancestors who've been here because they have white ancestors as well. They have ancestors who've been here just as long as anybody can trace white ancestors. I once gave a talk at the Aristotelian Society about the concept of race. And a very nice middle-class lady at the back kept puzzling about why I had referred to myself at one point as English. And I said, well, my mother was English, and I can tell you where her ancestors were in England back to the 12th century. And she said, yeah, but you know what I mean. So I think you can't... That's the difficulty because the soil is imagined as it were, white people are imagined as it were having come, they're autochthonous, they come out of the soil here. We Asantes, my sisters are in the front row, we Asantes think of ourselves as having come out of the ground in Asante where we grew up. And so everybody else, we're nice to other people, we like having other people around, but they have to understand that we're the people of the soil, we're the people who came out of the ground. And I think that in the United States, because the people who came out of the ground here, the only people who have a plausible claim to that are American Indians. people want to call Native Americans now, but that seems to me not helpful since many of them call themselves Indians. So that doesn't work so well. But in Europe, you can do that. You can sort of say, well, we're nice to you and so on, and you're welcome here, but we and our ancestors came out of Uganda. And of course, that ignores the fact, among other things, that many of the ancestors of contemporary white people who are racialized as white in our kingdom came from the Norse world, or from they were Huguenots, or they were Spaniards. I mean, they Italians. They came from all over the place. Poles. But the fact that our particular racial categories put so much pressure on appearance means that if you don't look non-white, you can sort of pass into the norm in a way that's very hard if you don't. That's just a contingent feature of the particular form of racial thinking that we have. You can have forms of racial thinking which are not so heavily tied to physical appearance. And for those, questions of passing, I think, can become extremely urgent and interesting, which is why I think the Spaniards were so obsessed with the conversos, because they couldn't actually tell them apart. They couldn't actually tell who had Jewish ancestry, whereas they thought they could tell who had African ancestry.
You remember the controversy about Cheddar Man? Yes. The film, Cheddar Man is described as black in complexion. The people who considered themselves indigenous British were, meaning white, were not happy because that then raised the question of whether there was in fact a relationship between skin color and so-called indigeneity or coming from the ground. Who came from the ground in any place? How do you answer this question? Who came from the ground? And in America, I think it's interesting that because of the prior claim of American Indians to the land, the discourse is not so much land as blood. So blood has now come back. The white race is imperiled. The white race will become a minority. And it's gone back to being biological with a vehemence that is really, again, about trying to find a way to lay defensive claim to an identity.
I enjoyed the possible explanation for the Cheddar Man, including that he may have been here on holiday. I certainly recognise the description you made of Europe, but I would put back to you that there's a certain ranking that goes on in North America right now, surely, in terms of declaring yourself a seventh generation American. Seventh generation American, I have a claim on this.
People do that, though. Again, this is, I mean, this is one of those places where I think it's useful to draw people's attention to what the metaphor requires. I mean, if the thought is all my ancestors back to seven generations, we're all here, the answer is no. There's hardly anybody in the United States who's racialized as white. There's no ancestors who came to the United States after the mid-19th century. So, and if the claim is, well, I can trace it back through men, well, then the question is, why should we care about tracing things back through men? So I think you can sort of, when people start playing those games, I think you can draw attention to their presuppositions and ask them whether they really want to endorse the presuppositions. But sometimes they do. And not much you can do with those people except disagree with them.
You have a philosopher's capacity to appeal to logic and reason in the way in which social scientists tend to throw their answers, myself included. And I suppose the other thing I would say about the UK is that you only get to this frame of who is and who isn't British based on ancestry if you forget about the empire. The traffic across that for many centuries. What Britain was, in large part, was an imperial entity. Suddenly we're a state, suddenly we're a nation state. Relatively small period within the story of Britain and from Scotland, a nation which has completely forgotten its Roman Empire, looking down at the dirt that was nasty, chewing me through, and not nice like hers. They can only do that by uncoupling themselves from this imperial project, which is in our parents' life.
But having said that, I think we also have to think about the ways in which Britishness, and you see this very clearly with Brexit, is very dominated by Englishness. So yes, of course, the Scots and the Welsh and to some extent some Irish had a role to play in empire, or the Irish were also colonized. But I think that you know, Brexit, definition of Britain and who voted for Brexit, it turns out to be a heavy English vote. And so we also have to think about the ways in which Britain is constituted by empire on the one hand, but also in a disproportionate way by an empire which saw itself as English in values. I mean, you have Lord Macaulay talking about, you know, creating people who are English in every way but blood and colour. So yes, it was a British imperial project, but the British Empire was also heavily overrun by Englishness, and that has come back with a vengeance. I think to talk about that.
I think we need to talk about that one. I agree with it. Your first point, do you know the phrase the English owned the British Empire, the Scots ran it?
Yeah,
it's very true. About a third of the elite civil servants agree.
You mentioned Lord Macaulay.
I did. Yes. He saw himself as English.
Yes, he did.
Of the East India Trading Company was Scots. When you think about the population size of the town, it tells you something about the role that the Scottish civil servant wants to play in the sense.
Well, and the Jute in Dundee, we have very material connections to
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's very hard to... So one thing I've never been able to explain to anybody in America is why the use of the word British to refer to everybody in England is not necessarily, and I mean England, is not necessarily helpful in understanding how people are thinking about themselves. So for example, my mother was not British, as far as I can tell. My mother was English. and she came from the west of England. And her sort of literary references and her sense of what landscape is and so on, these were all tied up with English poets. Maybe it's run north of the Lake District, but still. But whereas British is this category, it's essentially a category produced for the empire, and partly out of the Napoleonic Wars, a conflict with the French over imperial stuff. So it's not very old, the idea. I mean, there's the United Kingdom, but that's the union of some crowns.
That's not very old.
That's not very old either. So I think, one reason why it's hard to explain Englishness is because part of Englishness is a resistance to theories about things like Englishness. So the English don't like theories about Englishness because I think it's un-English to care about such stuff. What you should do is sing with Flanders and Swan, English, English, English are best, I wouldn't give tuppence for all the rest. But you shouldn't have a theory of Englishness. And this distinguishes England as a sort of untheoretical from Britain, which I think is a legal and juridical and theoretical idea, and very distinctively from France, where France understands itself as an idea, not as something that therefore has to be thought about and theorized, and you have to teach people. Now, that doesn't mean there isn't a racial dimension in the French self-understanding. I think there is, though they debated it. I mean, they thought about whether, during the Revolution, they thought about whether whether they were going to have the kind of a notion of what France was that was defined by purely by ancestry, or whether they were going to have a notion of France defined by commitment to the ideas of the Republic and the Revolution. And everybody won that, and then it went back and forth. But still, there's a long tradition in France thinking of a French identity as something that can be theorized, and therefore transferred, right? Because it's a matter of having the right beliefs and so on. So in the mid-20th century, or the mid to late 20th century, one of the greatest French poets, in the view of people who study French poetry in France, was Léopold Sédar Senghor, the president of Senegal. Why? Because he spoke beautiful French, because he was engaged in the things that mattered to the French, because he believed in the Republic and the Revolution, and knew about Asterix and all that, and knew about
Molière and Racine, and the literature that mattered. So he could be, as he was, a member of the Académie Française, a foreign state, could be a member of the Académie Française, because he was committed to a certain picture of Frenchness. I don't think you could do that in England, because you can't, there's no analogous thing that you could, as it were, grab onto and say, okay, I've got that, so now you have to.
It's there a little bit around imperial Englishness and the idea of creating people who could be English. Yes. And English literature, my discipline, developed as a colonial enterprise. It exists in India before it exists in England properly. It's used to train civil service administrators, on the one hand, to be able to go off into the colonies and communicate English values, which were then mapped onto British values. It was also used, and this is one reason in a way that I'm in this room talking, is it was used to create a native elite class who Lord Macaulay described as English in every way but blood and colour. And again, English literature, which is the discipline I teach, was used to as the vehicle for culturally turning, a kind of cultural eugenics, turning people into people who had so-called English values and could communicate them and help govern. So he wanted a class of interpreters between us and the millions whom we govern, and he wanted a kind of brown English class, and it was actually in many ways a very, very successful project of cultural eugenics, and it's why it shapes India's relationship with Britain to this day.
Explains why there are so many Indian book authors.
Well, that too.
I suppose I want to push at the extent to which we're talking about the identity of particular racial projects, in this case, nation states, and people's national identity. And one of the things I find in your country, France, is that the French state is stuck in terms of self-identity. It's stuck in the 1958 version of what it is. Whereas actually when you survey French people, they actually have quite hybrid plural identity than what being French is, the racial character to it. But there's a fluidity in the way in which the state struggles with. And I would say that it's also true of Britain, though with the exception that the competition within self-definition of national identity in the UK is that Britishness is currently sustained by black and ethnic minorities in England and Protestants in Northern Ireland. When you look at survey data, census data, they're the people who will most strongly self-identify with that national identity. In Wales, they'll say I'm Welsh first, in Scotland they'll say I'm Scottish first, and the English in England will say I'm English. So you have this paradox where British national identity has to some extent been remade precisely at the point in which